So before we begin with the specific tools, methods for taxonomy cleaning, I'd like to give you a brief overview of the taxonomy assessments, waste assets, and depending on the assessment and the assessment results, we will use one or another different tool for the cleaning. So first of all, and just to make sure we're all on the same page, I'm going to introduce a bit of taxonomy and problems that happen with the taxonomy table. So taxonomy itself is a science for disciplines, according to the Convention on Biological Diversity, taxonomy is the science of naming, describing, and classifying organisms, which includes all living beings. And it does so by using morphological, behavioral, genetic, and biochemical observations, by which the taxonomists identify, describe, and arrange species into classifications. So there are two key concepts here, two different things here. And those are the identification and the classification. So taxonomy is both things. It's the identification of an organism and placing that organism in context with the rest of the living organisms. So taxonomy, the first one of these two, the identification, has to do with the names. Taxonomy is based on names. Names that have been used by humans forever to identify the living organisms. But until a Swedish botanist came in around 1753, and he developed the binomial nomenclature, until then there was no way to unambiguously identify an organism, because each language, each culture, had its own way of naming the animals and plants and every living organism. So thanks to the binomial nomenclature, organisms and groups of organisms were given specific names, which are what we call taxa. Typical taxa and plural taxa. So taxonomy, apart from names, has to do with the organization and classification of the organisms, put an organism in context with the rest of them. And this organization, these classifications, are mainly based on common features. So for example, each level on these classifications has a certain number of individuals, organisms, that, and all of them, each level, share some common features. So this is what we call taxonomic classification, the way of organizing this according to common features. I'd like to stress that out because it's important for the upcoming part of the session. So taxonomy itself has a strong subjective component. And why? Because the classifications are based on common features. But what I think are common features might not be the same as you think are common features, or what you think are common features. So the classifications depend on the expertise and point of view of the specialist. And so there have been lots and lots of episodes across the taxonomy, history of taxonomy, of different agreements between different taxonomies that result in removing names, in splitting taxa that were supposed to be the same. Some expert comes and says, no, these are two different taxa. Or the other way around, merging taxa, two taxa that were believed to be different are merged into a single name. And even if the name remains the same, the different organization of the levels, the different grouping, has also happened a lot. So let's see some of the most basic examples you already know, but with this different perspective. So let's begin with the synonymies. What happens with the synonymies? Synonymy is that when two different names are applied to the same organism. There are two different names for the same organism. This happens when an expert argues that two originally different taxa are in fact the same. In this case, it's generally one of the main remains, the other one, the other main remains. While the other is considered a synonym, and then it's no longer valid. You're not supposed to use synonym name if you have a value. I said generally because sometimes that happened that the original name was so old that it was considered an archaic form of the name. And then that's the name that's removed because it's no longer used. Everybody used the new one, so there's no point in referring to the old one. So this happened, for example, when Gray, in 1855, saw this animal and said, "Hey, this is, I'm going to call this an Antilocapra antiflexa because it's not the same as the Antilocapra americana, which was described by Ord 40 years before." What really happened is that what Gray saw was a very strange individual of Antilocapra americana. And so, further assessments saw that, in fact, Antilocapra antiflexa, which is the newest name, was not a new species, was another name for Antilocapra americana. So the old name is declared invalid because it's a genus synonym. Homonymies, the other way around, when the same name is applied to two different organisms. And this usually happens when somebody describes a new species that uses an already taken name, a name that's already used, referred to another organism, another type of organism. And in this case also, generally the oldest name remains, the one has to be removed and changed by a year. So an example of this is when Cuvier in 1797 saw this animal here and said, I'm going to describe a new genus and I'm going to call it Kip, without knowing that 20 years before, Foster called Echidna, used the Echidna name for a genus of this kind of organism. So, what happened here again is that Cuvier's sense of Echidna was found to be a homonym, and then was declared invalid. Because Foster, 20 years before, had used that name for another organism. What happened here then is that some 15 years after that, Iliger said, "Okay, what Cuvier called Echidna, I'm going to call it Tachyglossus. I'm going to make this the official valid name for this group of animals." Apart from changes in names, taxonomic classifications, forget about the names, let's focus on the classifications now. They are subjective, as I already said, because they are based on common features. Different experts might select different features and thus classify and organize groups with different individuals because they're based on different features. So, this is what I already said. So, see, for example, there's a website which is called InnoTaxa. These are very important that lets you explore taxonomy tree according to several different classifications. We can use, for example, the default classification, which is a hierarchy of names, the most commonly used one, but we can also select the Sharp and Champion classification, published in 1889 to 1911, which takes a specific group of organisms, the Pulcheria, type of Coleoptera, and reclassifies it, that group, according to certain pest features, certain invasive characteristics. So the scientific names remain the same, the species names remain the same, but the higher level names are different, and the organisms are grouped into different groups. So, these kind of issues, synonymies, homonymies, alternative taxonomy, make far inefficient the use of just a name to unambiguously work taxonomic data. So, what's the solution for this? A new concept was developed, taxon concept, which was ratified as a standard by the Biodiversity Commission standard, I think, John taxonomic concept is the union between a name and its context. The author that described that name, the classification that has been used, any other contextualization of that name, something that puts the name in a specific scenario so that it can unambiguously be determined. So with two different organisms, even if the scientific name is the same, the taxonomic concept would be different because it's applied to different organisms. The authorship might be different, or the classification might be different. This is a really good way, a proven good way to work with taxonomic information using the taxonomic concepts. So, if we check the Darwin Core Standard in search for taxonomic, for the way of representing taxonomic information, we find that there are lots of terms under the taxon class. And these terms make work with both taxonomic names and taxonomic concepts. For the taxonomic names, we can find fields such as scientific name, or on the higher taxon, kingdom, family, classes. And also some terms related to the taxonomic concept, such as the taxonomic ID. The name according to the name published in a lot of terms that give a context to the name, to the used name. And in fact, if we see the description of, for example, name according to, we find that name according to is the source in which the specific taxon concept circumscription is defined or implied. And for taxa, that results from identifications or identified organisms, name according to is a reference to the keys, monograph, experts, and other sources used for that identification, which should be given. That's a way of putting context to a name. So, what kind of issues can we find in taxonomic data now that we know how to difference between taxonomic names by themselves and taxonomic concepts? One of the most common issues are misspellings, which can be defined as not an official definition, but they can be defined as a random alteration of one or more characters in a name. Misspellings can be due to several factors. Two of the most common, they can be purely accidental. They can happen by random chance, or can be due to a low knowledge of the specific name we are using. And they tend to appear in technical digitization when transcribing from a field notebook to a computer, to a database, to a spreadsheet, a text file. So for example, if we're working with this bat genus, the biggest trellis, and we have in our field notebook the name, we try to digitize that name, and we can either by chance or because we don't know how it's truly written, we can insert some inaccuracies in the names, like for example using a single L with spells, or doubling any P or any other type of misspellings. Another issue are misidentification, which are more obscure type of issue because most of the times, there's no way to know if an identification has been right or wrong. Remember when I talked about the different types of occurrences? We have recent specimens or field observations.